10月24号到11月27号，应国家主席习近平的邀请，捷克共和国总统米洛什·泽曼来华进行国事访问。今年呢，恰逢中国和捷克建交65周年，在中捷双方的共同努力之下，中捷关系又重新恢复了生机与活力，站在了新的起点上。用今年4月来华访问的捷克外长的话来说呢，就是进入了重启的阶段。在繁忙的行程当中，捷克总统泽曼于10月27号的上午接受了访问。那么呢，我们首先来看一下我的同事水晶毅对他的专访。
Thank you very much for having this interview here. And I also know this is the first visit by a Czech president in 10 years. 15 years for you, the second time, and 10 years for a Czech head of state. So tell us, what's this trip all about?
But first, ni hao to your visitors.
Thank you.
And second, well, 15 years is important difference in the life of human being.
That's right.
But also in the life of the country, of the China. And instead of polite phrases about your expansion, your excellent dynamics of economy, I'll tell you one example only.
Wow.
The exports from China to Europe 15 years ago was represented mainly by textile, very cheap textile.
That's right.
And it practically eliminated the textile factories in majority of European countries.
Exactly.
Now I studied the statistic, and the share of textile exports from China on total exports is less than 10%.
Mm-hmm.
How could I demonstrate the progress you did? You export high technology, modern equipment, computers, and so on and so on. Yes? Thanks God, not the beer. The beer, the Czech beer, is to be exported to China, not contrary-wise. But as for the structure of your export, it is a good description of modern and prosperous country.
Mm-hmm. So it's a big change.
A big change, of course, sometimes you must pay, for instance, by the smoke. And now, because we have had the same experience, not only with the smoke, but with dirty water, yes. So we produced the equipment how to clean the air, how to clean the water, and again, this is the export article for China from Czechia. So there is simply division of labor, exchange of experience, and it is advantages for both countries. It is called, as you know, win-win strategy.
That's right, win-win strategy for our two countries. Now, this year is the 65th anniversary of bilateral relations between the Czech Republic and China. And so actually we have a long and traditional relationship between our two countries. And I noticed your foreign minister just a few months ago when he visited China, he used the term reset. That is to reset our bilateral relations after a period of comparatively not so activity, so much activity. So Mr. President, tell us, what is your understanding of resetting Chinese and Czech relationship?
Mm-hmm. It is like in the case of computer, reset of computer also. I should even say that we have new, a better computer just now. Because at first, we fully understand that it is not possible to interfere the internal relations of any country, including China. It's something Confucius said, yes, if you have no office, you cannot interfere into the affairs of this office. You must have the function, yes. That's why, for instance, I quoted Confucius in my TV discussion for Czech TV yesterday about Hong Kong, and I said I am the president of Czech Republic. I am not governor of Hong Kong, and that's why I do not interfere into the internal affairs of Hong Kong.
I see. So this is your understanding.
Yes, and this is the reset. Yes. So we do not teach market economy or human rights or something like that. And contrarywise, we try to learn. And I am in China in order to learn how to increase economic growth and how to stabilize society. And on the other side, if we may help a little, our favorite Yan Shu, you know it?
Yes.
Wonderful. Every family in China knows Yan Shu. So this is better than to give the lectures, to show Yan Shu. May I show you Yan Shu?
Okay.
Yes, yeah. I have it with me.
Yes, come in. Yeah.
Yes, well, they'll come.
Yeah, no problem. Oh, it's
and from economic reasons, it is excellent, excellent export article. Yes.
That's right. Wow.
But it is.
I should have a panda with me.
It is not only export article. It is the pleasure, mainly for the children. And just today, I will, in presence of your Mr. President, sign the treaty about the cooperation China and Czechia and cereal Yan Shu and panda, both animals, yes. So this is again a concrete example of friendly cooperation, not mutual criticism and learning instead of teaching.
And I think it's also a revival of the good feelings and good relations between our two countries. Including me, a lot of Chinese people, quite several generations, watched Little Mo or Yan Shu. It's kind of a name card or a symbol of the Czech Republic. And also, as I said, it's a kind of revival of the good relations between our two countries for so many years. Now, Mr. President, so you just mentioned Yan Shu, and we know that my television, CCTV, is going to have a cooperation with the Czech partners to do a series of news stories of Yan Shu.
Yan Shu and panda.
And panda.
Yes.
How do you like this idea?
Well, the Yan Shu will be a little greater than in reality. Panda will be a little smaller in order to be approximately on the same level.
I see.
Yes.
I see.
But I think it is a wonderful idea because of both are symbols of our countries. Yes.
Ah.
And every country has its history. Yan Shu, of course, is modern history. Panda is very old history.
Yeah.
So you have deep roots, you know. Czech Republic is a country which started as a state in 1993.
Uh-huh.
Czechoslovakia in 1918. So this is the difference we must understand mutually. Our symbol is very new and very young.
Small.
Yes. And your symbol, panda, is very old and traditional.
I see. That this is a very good symbolic symbolism of our two countries.
除了签约具有友好象征意义的鼹鼠和熊猫动画片以外，捷克总统此次访华的行程还带着重要的经济合作任务。根据报道，在刚刚举行的第九届中国欧盟投资贸易科技合作洽谈会期间，泽曼总统带领将近200人的捷克代表团前往成都。而除了这个庞大的总统团以外，他还带去了3架轻型飞机亮相欧盟馆捷克展区。而就在一年前，在中国西部国际博览会首次亮相的捷克轻型飞机，曾被媒体惊呼犹如珍珠一般。有评论称，此次捷克代表团的强势出席，无疑是中捷关系重启的最好开始。泽曼总统在接受采访时也强调，中捷关系的重启不仅仅是一个口号，更有许多具体的行动。
And I noted that people say your delegation is a presidential delegation. And, we can do a lot of business together because, you know.
Well, of course.
Yes.
But instead of presidential delegation, I have it myself more than 80 entrepreneurs, so-called business delegation. And we try to concentrate on very pragmatic questions like Big Silk Road. Yes,
that's right.
That is direct route between Prague and some of the Chinese towns. Yes, because you cannot travel by camels but by planes. We have discussed the possibility of Czech General Consulate in Chengdu, yes, because visa facilitation is also necessary in order to help the development of tourism, yes. We prefer exchange of students, yes. And so on and so on. By the way, in Czechia there is Academy of Confucius. Yes, and we have many researchers and scientists who were engaged in study of old China. So I think a restart you have mentioned is functioning and new computer is doing very well. One of the next arguments is my discussion with the chief of Bank of China, and there will be new branch of this bank just in Prague.
In Prague?
Yes.
Wow.
So, concrete, pragmatic steps, not only polite phrases.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, another question, let's move a little bit international. The Ukraine crisis. You are, Czech is the... is in the middle of Europe and you are close to the so-called conflict. How do you see this crisis? Is it going to turn into a kind of a new Cold War or it's going to be a kind of a, let's say, confrontation between the West and countries like Russia?
At first, we must understand the substance of the crisis. And according to my opinion, it is the civil war, not predominantly Russian aggression, but simply the civil war. And this war in influence by European Union, the states, the Russia, and so on and so on, but still the substance is the civil war. So at first you need ceasefire. At second, you need negotiations. It was done in Minsk, if you remember, you know, in last weeks, yes. But still, yes, the third stage, parliamentary elections now, and, well, decentralization of Ukraine, yes. in order to give the regions some competences, including using of the language they speak. Yes, one of the first steps of the new government of Ukraine was been the cancellation of Russian language on the territory of Ukraine. It was complete nonsense. Yes, so it was one fact which provoked, I guess, the civil war.
I see. So sanctions could not work.
Well, I think that sanctions produce the new Cold War. I agree. The sanction lead to isolation, and more than that, sanctions are the obstacle for economic development for all countries, not only the country where the sanctions are applied, but also the countries which apply the sanctions. On both sides, it is loss-loss strategy, not win-win strategy, but loss-loss strategy.
Loss-loss strategy. Okay, Mr. President, thank you very much for having this interview. Well, it's very nice. Thank you.
谢谢。
谢谢。Thank you very much. And also the 鼹鼠。
Yes, once more.
Yeah.
Once more.
Thank you very much.
好，我们刚才看到的是我的同事水军毅对捷克总统泽曼进行的专访。我们演播室呢还请来了中央党校国际战略研究所的副所长高祖贵先生来为我们做分析点评。欢迎您，高先生。刚才呢我们一同观看了水军毅对于泽曼总统的专访啊。在这个专访当中呢，虽然只有十几分钟的时间，我们刚才看到的啊，但其中呢不知道您注意到没有，泽曼总统用了很多中文的表述，比如说对于捷克这个名片，他用鼹鼠来表达，对于孔子学院，他说了孔夫子，还说你好和谢谢。从这样的表述当中，我们是不是可以看到泽曼总统对于发展中捷关系的这样一种诚意？
确实可以从他看来，他做了很充分的准备，而且他对中国的感情也是比较深的，所以他才能体现出来，他说了很多中文话。
嗯，
而且我注意到他在推销捷克的时候，让中国更好了解捷克的时候，他让拿着鼹鼠这个东西拿出来了，
形象
这中国人很多人都很熟悉和了解的。
上世纪八十年代，很多人都看过，
很多像我这个年龄都已经曾经看过他的动画片。所以从这个角度，他现在要做的就是接着写，就是电视连续剧，他要把这个鼹鼠的故事，然后和熊猫的故事结合起来。
嗯，
其实是一个很好的一个人文交流的。
现在您刚才用一个词叫接着写，
接着写。
其实如果我们看以前中捷两国之间的历史的发展，应该说是有悠久的历史和交往的传统，但是中间毕竟也受到过一些影响，所以现在是续写，
而且中间大家都经过了努力之后，已经跨过这个阶段了。
嗯，
我们知道，其实两国关系，1949年我们中华人民共和国建国的时候就建交了。建交之后呢，到了当时冷战时期，我们同属一个社会主义阵营。
嗯，
那么到了1993年的时候，他刚才提到过，那么捷克和斯洛伐克就分家了，就是捷克和斯洛伐克分离了。
嗯，
那么在1994年，中国和捷克方面就签署一个协议，重新确认说我们两国的关系还是从1949年算起。
嗯，
所以今年是65周年的7年周年。那么相关的都确定了之后，从那个时候开始之后呢，我们看到的是从90年代，因为捷克和中东国家在寻求加入欧盟、加入北约，后来呢就是它是那样一个进程。那么中国主要是在和整个西欧国家在发展关系，但经过这10年之后，08年的金融危机，双方开始发现对方。在中东欧国家包括捷克在内，他们此前的那些经济发展受到影响，受到金融危机的影响之后，他们寻求新的市场，寻求，然后他们自然的当时的欧洲受到很大冲击之后是受到很大影响了。
嗯，
他们就把眼光投向了中国，因为中国是08年金融，我们率先走入金融危机，而且整个发展态势很好。
嗯，
这种时候他们扩大加强和中国合作的需求很大。那么同样的，我们在这种情况下，我们也希望让中东欧国家发挥我们进入到加强和整个欧洲国家合作、整个欧盟合作的一个桥梁的这种作用。
嗯，
所以我们现在就力图把这个双方的潜力给它挖掘出来。
所以现在就是说，这个鼹鼠和熊猫合作的新时代已经到来了，
这个新时代
要抓住这个契机。
对，
嗯，
而且这个新时代从现在来看，好像不仅非常务实。我注意到他这个总统，他特别强调， 政治方面呢，他非常尊重中国的主权，然后不干涉任何中国的政治，
谈得很清楚，
这一点很鲜明。在这个基础上，然后现在形成一个很好的合作，经贸领域双方的互补性是很强的。从他提到这个飞机到那个展示的机械制造飞机啊，还有其他一些领域，这个有很好的互补性。还有一个人文交流，他这个鼹鼠和潘德熊猫这个故事，那么包括其他的像科学家啊、孔子学呀、这些东西交流之后，那么人文交流也会进一步扩展。这样的话，双方的话，他是用了一个很形象的词，就是说这个换。不是重启一台计算机，而是换了一套很好的计算机。也就是中捷关系经过这一次访问之后，那么会进入到一个新的更好的阶段。习主席讲的来之不易，大家会抓住机会把它推到一个更好的阶段。
对，用泽曼总统比喻，这是一台新的计算机。其实我们知道，早在2012年的时候啊，中国和中东欧的这个所谓的16+1，中东欧有16个国家+1+中国这个平台已经初步建立。到了2013年的时候呢，中国国务院总理李克强访问了罗马尼亚，并且和这个中东欧的16国总理进行了会晤，共同发表了一个叫《中国中东欧国家合作布加勒斯特纲要》。这个纲要的发布，其实就标志着这样一个16+1的阶段已经开始往前继续推进了。其实我们知道，中国和东盟也有一个10+1的这样一个合作机制。我们看到这个每年中国东盟这个搞这个博览会的时候，都会有一个标语叫10+1大于11。现在这个机制在不断的发挥作用。那么中国和中东欧的这个合作机制，如何让16+1大于17？如何让16个中东欧的国家看到这个大于号？中国要怎么做？
从现在来看，我们知道有意思的是，这个中东欧16+1这个经贸起初是经贸论坛，后来到了2011年开始这个论坛，而且2012年之后才开始这个首脑级的会晤，那么2013年开始搞，今年接着搞。最初的2011年那个经贸论坛就是从捷克开始的，所以捷克显然在这个实际上它起到了一个非常好的一个促进和引领的作用，
它更积极，
那么从现在来看的话，我们16+1要大于17，因为现在的中东国家它在中国和欧盟整个欧盟之间，它是一个很好的一个桥梁作用。它一方面，我们和中东国家这16个国家里面的大量的经贸，而主要是在和它加入到欧盟成员里面，那些是中东国家发生的。如果说我们和整个的中东16个国家这个都能够很好的像现在这一次访问那样，各个领域的合作潜力都激发出来的话，那么显然中东国家既有了它那边欧洲的一个大的市场和需求，同时和中国有了一个很好的一个合作，这样的话他们在两边之间它都可以，就是两边双方的好这个利益它能够得到充分的发挥。那么这样的话对于中国来说，也可以从此这个作为一层桥梁，更好的进入到整个欧洲的大市场里面。这显然是一个可以说是不仅是双赢的一个事情，还是对于整个欧洲的是一个三赢的事情。
不过我们看到这次在接受采访的时候，这个泽曼总统也表现出了对包括乌克兰危机这样地区性问题的担忧。像现在我们有一个了解说，这个捷克航空公司啊，因为这个相关的问题已经解雇了36%的员工了。其实这个地区的问题对于捷克的影响是不是也比较大？简单的说，
确实如果对比现在这个中东国家合作的角度来，现在的捷克在乌克兰危机面临一个像他这样的一个国家面临一个很大的挑战。如果乌克兰危机能够顺利的得到软着陆的话，那么他们的会受到的冲击很小。如果他们继续冲突的话，显然他们会成为美俄博弈的一个前沿阵地。
所以在这样危机的状态之下，可能发掘新的合作空间，就像那个小鼹鼠一样，拿那个铲子去发掘更深的合作，是捷克和中国以及很多国家都需要做的事情。
是这样。